So I would like to welcome Dr. Moshmi Patil. She is an eye surgeon specialized in corneal and refractive surgeries. She completed her bachelor and post-graduation degrees from Mumbai. Subsequently, she has completed fellowships in cornea and refractive surgery from the Arvind Eye Institute, Madurai, India and Singapore National Eye Center. In addition to the attachments in large urban hospitals, her work experience includes several stints in rural areas of outskirts of Mumbai and South India. It is in these locations that ma'am had the most interesting experiences and saw the meaningful use of her medical training. She is also an author of several articles and research papers in her area of expertise. Welcome, ma'am.
Yeah. Hello. Hi. Good evening, everyone. Hope you can hear me.
Yes, we can hear you. It's great to have you here.
Hi.
So let's get into it. So, ma'am, what's your graduation? What are the subjects that you took up in your, what's your background? What are the subjects that you took up in your schooling and graduation?
Okay, so I have done ophthalmology, that is eye surgery. And so after that, I have done a fellowship in cornea and refractive surgery. So just to start off with, like basically, I have completed my schooling, undergraduation and post-graduation in India and basically in Mumbai. And just one fellowship in Singapore. So to start off with, like just in brief, after the 10th grade, I picked up the science stream with basic subjects, you know, which you need to consider if you want to go into medicine are biology, chemistry and physics. And in my case, I had math also, but it was secondary. Like these were the three more important subjects. Mm-hmm. So after that, after the 12th grade, like basically I applied for this entrance exam. I took up this, pursued this entrance exam. We, at that time, during my time, we had a state a central examination test to enter into MBBS. So that's like bachelor's in medicine and bachelor's in surgery. And we could either go for like the national-based exams or the state-based exams. I had taken the state-based exam.
Okay.
And after getting ranked there, I entered the MBBS course. And this course is basically, it's like the most prominent graduate degree to become a doctor. So after getting this degree, which is the Bachelor of Medicine and Bachelor of Surgery, either you can get into a government institute or a private institute. So it's like a five and a half year course, including 1 year of compulsory rotating internship. So this 5 year or 5.5 year course has an academic year of 4.5 years. So this academic year is again divided into 3 years. So the first year is of 1 year, and it consists of human anatomy, then biochemistry and physiology. The second year is having pharmacology, pathology, microbiology and forensic. And the third year is then further divided into 1 year each, where the first subdivided into 1 year each. So the first part of the first year, third year, is having ophthalmology, ENT, that is your nose and throat, and ESM. And the final year is basically is having all the clinical subjects like medicine, surgery, gynecology, and pediatrics. So these are all the subjects which basically you overall cover in your MBBS curriculum. Now, once you have covered, finished the academic year of MBBS, then we need to undergo a 1 year rotating internship where depending upon your hospital or the institution, wherever you are. So you are offered various rotations in your hospital as well as other hospitals, maybe in rural areas as well. So I had to do a 3-month rural internship as well. So that you get the rural exposure. After that, once you finish your MBBS course, then you can either become a general physician and practice, have your own private practice or get attached to a hospital. Or in today's era, definitely you need to do a specialization. So since I was interested in ophthalmology, definitely I took up that that specialty. And
yes.
That's like another 3-year course. Like for that, okay. You again need to give an entrance examination. So that's a national-based examination, or either government through, or maybe like if you want to try, you can try via various private institutions as well. So that's a 3-year postgraduate course. And not the least, because now even the specialty is like, you know, there is too much of like congestion in that, and there's so much knowledge in a particular specialty. So I have done a specialization like in ophthalmology, basically there are 7 subspecialties. So I have picked up the most anterior part, that is the cornea and the refractive surgery. So that's another, it depends, like either you can take a fellowship, which is a long-term fellowship, or a short-term fellowship. So you, for this fellowship, you need to apply to various institutions, whoever are offering them. So I have done 1 year, 1.5 year fellowship from one institute in South India. And that's Arvind Eye Institute, Madurai. And another fellowship of 1 year from Singapore National Eye Center.
All right. Wow, that is very extensive and wonderful. Okay. So what are the job opportunities one can do after pursuing a degree in ophthalmology?
Basically, overall, it's just not like ophthalmology, but if you consider the entire medicine field, you know, I mean, this is applicable to the entire medicine field. You just need to find out what exactly you are interested in. Now, since ophthalmology is a surgical field, so it's like you can practice medicine as well as surgery in that. Right. So if you divide the job opportunities into like medicine as well as non-medical. So in medical, maybe you can have your own practice, where you can start your own private practice and start seeing patients there. Or the other alternative could be like you can get some attachment to a hospital, either work as a full-timer where you are completely attached with the hospital the entire day, or maybe you can get some partial attachment where you can work there on a slot basis. Maybe then at that time, you can, since you are you've done your subspecialty as well, right? So you can get attached to various hospitals who require someone who's subspecialized in that. So 2 to 3 hospitals, and then maybe private as well along with that. Even that is possible. But then you need to just adjust your timings and, you need to manage the time pattern. So that's one option. And lastly, in considering the medical part, obviously research is always there. So especially in India, that there are quite a few institutions who do a lot of research into genetics, then tissue engineering.
Yes.
There are a lot of upcoming things which are coming up in ophthalmology per se. So that's one area of interest. You can become a research scientist or a research clinician, or you can have a combination of both. Get attached to a hospital who is doing a lot of research, and simultaneously help them in the research activities, and then you can help them in the various tissue engineering process and etc., whatever you're interested in. And this is the medical part of the job opportunities. Now, considering the non-medical part, after becoming an ophthalmologist, you can also get attached to various pharma companies, work with some insurance companies, some of the companies which are offering a lot of equipments, medical equipments, because ophthalmology is a field where you need a lot of equipment-based field. So you need an equipment for everything, whatever you do. You cannot examine a patient. There are a lot of equipments required. So you can get attached to some of the industry which is making such equipments. Or last but not the least, non-profit institutions like Help Me See And like many eye-related, there are many eye-related nonprofit institutions, so you can help them. Now, in my case, like I was also attached with an eye bank. Now, since I have specialized in cornea, like we need a lot of corneal tissue for eye transplantation, because that is one of the tissues which is required that if someone loses vision and because of any cornea-related issue, then we need those corneas from the donors who pass away. And so I was attached with this eye bank as well, where we need to like examine the corneas and see whether they are okay for transplantation, whether they are suitable, and then we can use them further. So even that's like one of the options.
That is great. So what did you enjoy the most when you're pursuing your degree? So you mentioned even in the write-up, you said that, you know, in the rural areas, that's where you learned a lot of things and you had a lot of interesting experiences. So, yeah. So if you could just elaborate on what you enjoyed the most during when you were pursuing your degree.
Yeah. So, like, basically, first to just start off is, like, many people have this mental block, you know, that once you're into medicine, that's, like, it's only study, 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 you know, that's the end of life. And, like, there is nothing beyond beyond studying, you know, but I don't think that is correct. Like, obviously, you have to study because considering the fact that it's considering, like, you know, that there is, it's a field which is undergoing a lot of changes, like every moment. It is quite vast and you need to be updated. So reading and studying is important, but you can definitely have your hobbies as well. You can fulfill all your hobbies, whatever you are doing. Like I was studying during my undergraduate level, we used to have a lot of extracurricular activities. So I was always a part of that because that will help balance, you know, so it doesn't become like monotonous, because otherwise you will be just studying throughout. So I guess what I enjoy the most, especially in this field, is like dealing with patients, like especially there are challenges which you need to face like in everyday life. And every patient is different. Like, you know, it's not that if a patient has a particular illness, like say illness A, so the answer to that illness is B. It's not like that. So the answer could be either from A to Z, you know. So that's like, I feel it's more fascinating because it's very challenging because you need to make strong decisions. You need to have the rightful thinking. Also, employing knowledge to save someone's vision is very important. And especially in medicine as a whole, you need that knowledge to save someone's life. So I think it's just a balance what you need to maintain between both. And as you mentioned, like in rural areas, especially those people really, like really care about you a lot, because especially in ophthalmology, like those people are like they lose vision and their vision is just like maybe finger counting, you know, and they come to a tertiary or primary center, healthcare center after quite some time. And till then, they are okay with it. They're pretty happy with it. It's not like the people who stay in the cities, where even a slightest deterioration in vision would affect them. So in rural areas, when you work, it's like the thing is when they get good vision, there would be like gratitude that they're like really thankful, and you feel really good after that. So these experiences I had in those rural areas, they're quite nice, actually.
All right, that is wonderful. Okay, so how do you think STEM will progress in the coming years?
I think it's like STEM is going to like explode, like in terms of opportunities, because today, if you today's era, like there are so many areas like artificial intelligence and nanotech and stem cell sciences, so which are going to take a quantum leaps. So this will have an impact on all the STEM branches. So I don't think there is any better time to be in STEM, you know. So it's like, considering the fact like there is such a lot of computer revolution which is going on, so it's just going to explode, I feel.
Agreed. How did you, we're very grateful that we have a person like you who can explain to us that even when after you finish your MBBS, you've studied and then you told us what exactly you've studied and the opportunities available. But at your time, when you were, say, in the 12th grade, how did you decide that, you know, MBBS is the right thing to do? And even after that, how did you decide that ophthalmology excited you so much? Or, you know, this is what you wanted to pursue ahead?
During my schooling days, you start off with the schooling days, right? So I always used to like science. Science used to always fascinate me, you know, like amongst all the various subjects like history, geography, and the languages and science. So science was one of the subjects in which I used to always take a lot of interest. And even in science, since we have botany and zoology, right? So zoology used to really interest me a lot. So human anatomy per se. So it was at that time that I really thought if I have to make a career, you know, the science would be medicine basically would be one of the careers I would definitely opt for. And taking this into consideration, I remember when I was in eighth grade, we had we had to make a project in science. I mean, you can choose whatever field you want, you know, anything you feel like. And I had made a project on the eye anatomy, ocular anatomy in my grade eight. So, and I had received a lot of appreciation actually for that project. So I feel the roots were, you know, there at that time itself. So, so as I said that, you know, that was a start where I liked science. So after 10th, I took up the science stream. Then in the 11th grade and 12th grade, again, as I mentioned, zoology really interested me. So that was the time. So and in MBBS, once you're into medicine, then you have to anyways study all the subjects initially. So that's you don't have any other option. You have to study all the subjects. It's only at that time when I was anyways into, I had my posting in ophthalmology. Actually, ophthalmology, we don't have that much of posting in the entire MBBS curriculum. So it's maybe just 1 month. But it's in your final year, but your subject, obviously you have a posting which is there in the third year. It's one of the main subjects. But you're not we are not exposed to a lot of stuff that we definitely see in a post-graduation. But at that time, I started liking the subject and I felt that's that would be one good subject to take up, because as you know, ophthalmology is, there are not a lot of emergencies. So I thought that even in future, to have a good personal and professional life, that would be one of the good subjects that I could take up.
Okay, that is great. Okay, so you already mentioned that while you were pursuing your degree, even at that time, interacting with patients was quite a lot of fun. But what do you enjoy as of now? What do you enjoy the most about your job as of now?
I think what I mentioned is the outcome, which is more important, especially. So seeing a patient gain vision is most rewarding thing you can have, what I feel. And giving him the best possible vision. It's not that you're trying to experiment. It's telling them the truth, whatever it is. If you are going to get good outcomes, then tell them that, you know, that you will get. But if you have a slightest doubt and you feel that this patient is not going to benefit, then just be open-minded and just tell them. So I think that's, and I think patients then also become they try to adapt themselves to the scenario, and definitely, they will try to consider it, and then they will be that obviously this doctor is being really telling us the truth, at least not telling us, giving us false assumptions or false statements. So I think what I enjoy is again, as I mentioned, like, it's a very challenging field, and every day you get to see like new things and new challenges. And since it's also a microsurgical field, so as you know, I always like to do, like, always wanted to do microsurgeries and excel in that. So
okay,
that's one thing I feel is like, I'm really happy about it.
All right, that is amazing. So how difficult is it to be an ophthalmologist?
It's like not only an ophthalmologist, but once, like, you know, you are into medicine, like, even if you complete medicine, it is like you see that if you have parents, like, you know,
yes,
who are there into a particular medical field, then it is definitely like a head start for you. And then you have a lot of things which are like sorted out. Like, they are there to guide you at most of the like steps and most of the paths. Otherwise, it becomes a little difficult because you have to research by yourself. Then you need to excel in most of the, like, you need to excel in most of your exams. But in a nutshell, like, you know, unless and until you're very exceptional or you don't have a platform, then life is not going to be like very easy for you. Maybe it's like an ophthalmologist or any doctor, you know, anyone in medicine. So
yes.
I think, like, if in India, definitely it's like many people have their parents who are doctors, so they have like their own setup. So that being like, it's a bit different for them, you know, because so it becomes little easier. But otherwise, you can get attachments to hospitals and, you know, have good credentials, do some research. So that everything definitely helps. So a good idea, what I feel is like, you need to think out, like, you know, out of the box, like, just be an ophthalmologist and maybe like do some research activities that can add up to your CV, and then you can get some good attachments in future.
Okay. Yeah, makes sense. All right. So what are the key skills required to become an ophthalmologist?
First of all, like, since it's a microsurgical field, so you need to have good hand-eye coordination, then focus, concentration, those are the add-ons. Then definitely curiosity, like, what if this, like, you know, what if you do this surgical procedure and maybe you can try doing something else which will give good results, like, you know, so
you need to
know exactly what you do, because it's like the best possible vision you can attain in the first surgery, you know. And definitely you can try out doing, you can get good outcomes even in subsequent cases. But then what I feel is like reasoning, you need to reason out like what a particular patient needs, like the timeline for the management, that's important. And last but not the least, like huge patients, you know, I mean, that's really important.
Yes. Okay, so this will be my last question, and all the people that want to ask a question, they can type it out in the chat box or they can raise their hand and I'll be recognizing them after ma'am has answered the last question. So ma'am, any final piece of advice you would like to give us budding girls in STEM?
Yeah, sure. So what I feel is like, keep yourself at the center of your choice. I mean, what you personally connect with is most important, you know, like even in your grades, like the schooling grades, you need to know like what you like exactly. You need to find out your liking, but it will supply you only with the drive during a hard times. Like, so you need to spend some time and try to speak to people. Definitely like forums like this will definitely help you, because they will at least help you go and research into a particular field if you are interested in. Then maybe you can talk to more people. You can write to them. Maybe you can meet them as well. Like, you know, have a like one-to-one conversation. Then like obviously spend some more time. Basically, I feel just don't rush to like if someone tells you, you know, this is a good field, you know, I think you should try out. It's not like even after giving exams, like entrance exams, and suppose you don't get like good ranks, then there is no need to like feel disappointed. Maybe you can like invest one more year. It usually happens in the medical field. Like, you know, you don't, even if you secure a particular rank, not necessary that you will you will get a good institution, because it's very important to get a good institution as well. You would not want to go into some peripheral hospital, you know, where there is not much exposure. So maybe you can like sit back 1 year, because 1 year at the start of your career is not going to make a difference. But if you be hasty during that period, then maybe it might count on the long run. So it's okay if you like spend 6 more years, you know, more than your friends, or maybe like, you know, more, don't get pressurized with people around. First you sit down and try to find out your interests. I think that's more important.
Agreed. Makes sense. So now we'll be waiting for questions. Okay, I already have some questions that people have asked me privately. What is your biggest accomplishment outside of the medicine field or academics?
Outside?
Yeah, so like something besides your practice, something besides your academics and your, you know, ophthalmology career. What is your biggest accomplishment?
I think most of the things have happened at the right time. So taking into consideration, I have tried to preserve my hobbies as well. So I like traveling. I like trying out different cuisines. Then I try to spend as much time as I can with the family. So I think that's also very important. And to have your hobbies, and to maintain a good personal and professional life. So I think that is the most important thing.
Yes, of
course. Keep you happy, because if you are just like into a profession, then maybe you will miss out main things, you know, there's some important things in life. So I think that's very important. Yeah.
Agreed. Keeping a balance is extremely important. Okay, someone else has asked, what have your research papers been about?
Most of them are when I was in ophthalmology, because being into medicine when you're doing MBBS, it's a little like difficult. So after like I was into ophthalmology and during my the postgraduate training, there were research papers were more about pertaining to like various diseases in ophthalmology, like suppose with relation to cataracts, then with relation to cornea, because I was more interested. So my research papers are more in cornea as per se. So considering the various corneal diseases, even now I am actually most of them are in the process of peer review. So maybe like if you check online after a few months, you will find 3 to 4 of them, which are ongoing. Actually, they are in process. So they're more related to cornea and the anterior segment of the eye. I will definitely not tell you exactly, because I don't think it makes sense, because you must not be having the background of that, but it's more of the anterior segment of the eye.
Okay. All right. That is related, amazing.
More related to clinical stuff rather than genetics or biomedics or something like that. It's more of the clinical stuff and basically summarizing most of the patients which I have seen.
Yes. All right. So someone else has asked me, can you tell us about traumatic iritis?
Yeah, so basically traumatic iritis is whenever a patient gets injury, could be injury with anything, any accidental injury or a road traffic accident or anything can, suppose it could be a penetrating injury or it could be a non-penetrating injury. So there is inflammation of the eye. So basically inflammation of the anterior part of the eye, the anterior segment of the eye. And in this condition, the patient will present to you with, first of all, pain, redness, as well as blurring of vision. So on torchlight examination, it's not possible to diagnose it. You need specialized instruments for that. So once you diagnose it, after seeing the inflammation in the anterior segment of the eye, then you need to treat it accordingly, according to the severity, basically. And also you need to, not only the anterior part, but since it's trauma, you need to per se examine the entire eye, because even though it's looking like that the infection has been limited to the anterior segment, there might be traces of it in the posterior as well. So you need to examine the eye overall after doing various investigations and so on, you know.
Yeah. Okay, all right. That is great. So, okay, someone else has asked, has being a woman ever affected your career in any way?
In the sense, like, being a woman, like, in the initial start of my career, not really, but later, like, maybe, like, because a woman has a biological clock, right? So, like, you need to, yeah, so, taking that into consideration, I mean, I think it's the same for everyone. So, there are times, like, where you need to slow down the pace of your career and take few breaks and put some pauses at a particular time. So so it was like when I had my child, so it was at that time when I had taken a break for a few months. And then when I started off with like very short duration of like consulting with basically getting attached, as I mentioned, like, you know, either you can be like get attached to hospitals with like where you can have constant like attachments over the entire day, or just get like partial attachments, which could be slot based. Maybe like, you know, you can go to a particular hospital maybe like for 1 hour or 2 hours. You can have that sort of an attachment with a particular hospital, and then as time passes, you can increase the times of work, and you know, then I think at the end, ultimately, it becomes okay. Yeah.
Okay.
So that's that. I think that every woman has to face. So, yeah. So I don't think that's different than any other field. I guess that's there in all the fields. Yeah.
Okay. So someone else has asked, did you ever feel like giving up because it's a long process? So it takes a lot of time to reach where you are. And what did you do if you felt like giving up?
Yeah, definitely. There are instances where you feel like it's enough now, you know, because there is no end to it. Because as I mentioned, you know, for me, like, I don't have a family background of anyone being into medicine. So everything would be whatever I've done up till now is by myself. So the thing is, it is definitely, you have time periods where you feel like, you know, now it's enough, you know, I just want to quit. That's it. But that's not the end. You just need to sit down, like, you know, have some friends around, have family around, and give some time for yourself, and, you know, like, have some conversations, and, you know, and then you'll get the best out of it. But definitely, when you're into medicine, you will definitely face this sort of a situation at some point in life. Yeah.
Yes. All right. Makes sense. So someone else has asked, how do you suggest we should do job shadowing? So I think because you spoke about, you know, talking to professionals, meeting them, having conversations with them, figuring out what they do. So someone has asked, how do you suggest we should do job shadowing?
Yeah, maybe first of all, you need to find out that exactly what in which field are you interested in. And then as these courses, like STEM is offering like so many forums, right? So like, if you're interested in like ophthalmology or into medicine, then maybe you can just write, like, send us a personal message, because we definitely share our email with the STEM team, right? So I'm just giving you an example in my case.
Yes.
So if anyone is interested in medicine or in ophthalmology, per se, then they can just like write to me on my email, and then maybe I can personally get back to him, like how they can investigate in the particular field they want, or how to go about, like I can at least brief them or can connect them to someone who has like recently been into this process of examinations and, you know, just the undergraduate level. So I can, like, maybe that's one way that you can, I mean, STEM can help these participants. Or in other cases, maybe, like, there are many forums, actually, like on LinkedIn or on Facebook. So you can also, like, text them there. And then maybe that's the way. It's like a chain process, you know. You connect to one person and maybe that person can give you the information or the contact of that particular person whom you really want to like talk to. So that's one way how you can, like, you know, go about it.
Yes, I completely agree with you, because even when we're trying to get even when we're trying to get speakers for these sessions, we end up cold emailing a lot of people. And like, thankfully, all of them have replied. You know, sometimes you email some far-fetched people and you feel like they might not reply to you. But most of them have replied. And yes, that actually works. So again, even on LinkedIn, we have a LinkedIn presence, and we've, you know, messaged some of our connections that are CEOs or in corporate or, you know, other places. So yes, I completely agree with what you're saying, and it does work.
And most of the people, I feel, is like they really enjoy, you know, helping others, because they have gone through that process and it's been like really tough for them. So I think to make life simpler for someone who's seeking, who wants to seek, like, you know, advice, or who is looking forward to that particular field, I guess most of the people would be really happy to share their experience and, you know, how to reduce the, like, how to make it more simple, basically, the process. So I think
makes sense. Okay, so we'll wait for another 10-15 seconds for any other questions, otherwise then we can end it. So okay, someone else has asked, were you always a student who did well until their 12th grade and that's why you chose the medical field?
Well, yeah, I was one amongst them. So ranking, like getting into the state levels and state level entrance examination also was like a bit easier for me, but it's okay. I don't think that really makes a lot of difference, because it's ultimately your hard work and dedication that's more important.
Right.
And what I feel is, like, as I already mentioned, like, if you fall short of like maybe like few grades in one attempt, don't like get disheartened, because there is always a second time, you know, and it's okay. Like, especially at the start of your career, it doesn't make a difference whether you have lost 6 months or you have lost 1 year. It's like, you should be more positive about it and consider it's like a gain in 1 year, maybe. It's like the knowledge that you have attained and that has helped you to get the career that you wanted. So it's pretty okay. Just don't think about the world, what the world says, like, you know, that, okay, she has lost 1 year and, you know, all that stuff is not important, because there are many candidates who actually sit back and give, like, two or three times they will give the exams, and then they will definitely excel in whatever they want, because they always wanted to do that particular thing, you know. So once in that, they always wanted to get into that particular career. So it's okay. Once they're into it, they actually like it, you know, and then they really excel in that. So just don't get disheartened if you are unable to get it in the first attempt. That's not the end of it.
Agreed. So on that wonderful note of not giving up and not getting disheartened, I think we'll end today's session. It was lovely having you here, ma'am. Thank you so much for coming on our forum.
And it was